So hello everyone, and I would like to present you 10 bite-sized case studies which are all based on the games which we tested together with our external studios or internally in Ketchup. So unfortunately none of those games became a hit, but we still published them because they had a real chance to become popular, to become profitable, and most of them actually were. And also they allowed us to collect those learnings which we are eager to share with you today. Let's get started. So first I would like to talk about time. Time is a crucial resource in hyper-casual, so we are trying to save it up everywhere. We are trying to automatize tedious SDK implementation, we are trying to automatize campaigns, but there is one old trick which we tend to forget, which is recycling, actually. So this is how we created those three prototypes. From left to right, you have Hyper Royale, Giant Thief, and Parkour Assassin. So those all three games were killed, unfortunately, due to high CPIs, but they had good in-game metrics. For example, for Parkour Assassin, you had 40% retention day one and 800 seconds. And it was quite good, so we wanted to experiment a little bit more with them. And creating, they have in common one thing. Actually, they have the same controls. It's a joystick-like control. We have a top-down camera and stickman characters, but the games are different, you're gonna see. So on the first, you have Hyper Royale, where we need to kill our enemies. And on the shrinking arena, like in Battle Royale, next, you need to steal a treasure from a giant. So without waking him up, if you wake him up, he's gonna chase you, like you can see on the video. And on the last one, you need to sneakily kill all of your enemies. So as you can see, three different prototypes, but with the same toy inside. So we basically reused the toy to create three different prototypes, and it allowed us to decrease the development time by half. It actually almost worked like an A/B test. So we were capable of seeing what the player likes in the game, what he dislikes, and now, based on those three games and their learnings, we are creating a fourth game, which we would like to share with you in upcoming months. So the key takeaway here is that if you have interesting features or if you have some interesting toys or maybe assets, don't hesitate to save up your time, reuse them, and you're gonna prototype faster this way. Next, we all probably face the problem how to retain our players for longer in your game. So the best way to do it without creating a lot of content is actually to come up with a gameplay which is deep. What does it mean deep? It means that your player has a lot of freedom to explore, a lot of freedom of action. Also, that means that there are plenty of in-game situations and that you can play the same level again and again and have different experiences. One of such cases was our game Rope Gun, which was proposed to us by our external developer Vlad. And we had good in-game KPIs, but we were hesitating about choosing different types of controls. First type of control which we wanted to test was one-tap control. As you can see, you just need to tap on a stickman and he automatically attaches to the surface. Very digestible, quite simple. And the second one was about two taps. So you need to tap on a stickman and on the place which, to which you attach this stickman. And we A/B tested it, and it turns out that the second type of control showed greater, better in-game metrics. The reason why is because it really allows for greater freedom. You can either kill your stickman with a box, or you can attach them together and make them collide, or send it really to the fan. So when you are trying to create a gameplay which is going to be attractive for players and retain them naturally, you need to think in terms of freedom. And it concerns your controls and your core gameplay. Always try to offer more situations, more replayability, so a player can have some freedom in the game. Next, I would like to talk about how to evaluate the content of your game. So you probably remember on the market, there was a time when drawing games were very popular. So at this time, our external partner, Bliss Games, came up with this game, which is called Draw Adventure. And it had good in-game metrics, but quite high CPI, actually. So initially, this game consisted of three main stages. So you draw your character, then you rig it, and then you kill all your enemies. But the high CPI was probably attributed to the fact that it's a bit long and not dynamic enough. So we started to ask ourselves, what can we do about it? And we actually were quite hesitant about this rig phase. From one hand, it allowed for some customization. On the other hand, it was just an obstacle between the player and the fun experience of killing enemies. So we removed it. And actually, we were totally right. The CPI decreased until 55 cents. And now we have a more dynamic gameplay. And also, we gained additional 2 minutes of playtime, which was perfect. And you can also pay attention to the fact that on the second video, we have Stickman. Meanwhile, on the first one, we have a monster. Stickman is more readable when you look at the video. It's easier to perceive it, but you can still see that you actually draw your character and you fight with it afterwards. So, don't hesitate to evaluate each phase of your game and ask yourself what kind of additional value it brings to your product, why the player should love it, and if you have any single doubt, just remove everything which is boring. And of course the theme, we talked a lot about the theme already, so the theme is getting more important in hyper-casual. Traditionally, we tend to opt for more neutral themes because they are actually more appealing to wider audience. You don't have any people which you scare off with this theme. But with the rise of social media like TikTok, we have noticed that actually theme has a really strong potential to boost the marketability of your game. So we sometimes tend to avoid some themes like very masculine themes, or some of quite niche themes, like probably fantasy. We don't use that in hyper-casual. But there are plenty of themes which seem equally marketable to us. How to choose the one which is the best for your gameplay? Actually, it should be, the reason is actually quite simple. It should be the perfect match with your core mechanic, with your core gameplay. And I have two interesting examples on this one. So at first, you can see we had a chasing game where we escaped from zombies as a naked man, and it had quite a bad CPI over $1. But as soon as we reskinned it to the thief, which is stealing a painting and then escaping from a museum, we got a 10 cents CPI. And the reason is why, because the thief theme matches perfectly with chasing gameplay. We are stealing stuff, they're chasing us, and it makes perfect sense for the player. And therefore, we got such a CPI. And another example about Garden Rescue. So it was a game with plenty of mini games where we collect stuff, where we spread water and plant different plants. And it also had a terrible CPI over $1. But as soon as we reskinned it to Fire Rescue, we got 18 cents CPI. The reason why is because firefighter setting makes way more sense when you spread water. It feels cooler, it's just more clickable. The player feels more powerful when he sees such a gameplay, and therefore the CPI was lower. So overall, you should always search for the perfect match for your core gameplay, for something which would organically fuse with your core gameplay. And of course, don't hesitate to A/B test your themes. It's also crucial nowadays. So, and continuing the topic about the theme and relatability, we actually noticed that relatability plays a huge role nowadays in hyper-casual. So it has the capacity to revive some old school gameplays, or at the same time, it can drastically reduce your CPI. And here is a case how we did it in on the game called Room Rage, which was proposed to us by our external partner, Abula Games. And we had a sticky core mechanic of destruction of a room, which had good in-game metrics, but a terrible CPI of $1 again. So we were thinking how to bring it closer to people. And so we added humans. Now it's not just an empty room which we are destroying. We have guys who are reacting to our actions, who are making funny faces, falling down, and it decreased the CPI by half. And it's not surprising. Actually, human beings are wired to react to other human faces. So, but it still was not enough. And we added another layer of relatability, which is storytelling. So now it's not just some random guys which you have in this room. You have an arrogant boss who is sitting in his cabinet. He's threatening to fire you. He is threatening to call the police, and you destroy his cabinet. You're taking revenge on him. So, of course, every time when you face the same challenge, try to add those layers of relatability on your games. Try to add human characters and give them small, relatable, readable stories, and also make them talk to your player. They react really well to that. So, and another case of lowering down the CPI, but this time we were focused on creatives, actually. So, we had a nice game brought to us by Bazinga Studio. And here, as you can see, you just need to make the guys fall by breaking the ground under their feet. And the CPI was, again, very high, but we loved the concept. So we dispatched our team of marketing artists in order to make different creatives and to try to find a sweet spot for the CPI. At the time, the puzzle games with pins were very popular. So we recreated the gameplay with those pins. And we also added a bear, so it looks more epic. Well, the bear didn't help, and the CPI was still 70 cents. But the creative which showed the best result was actually the simplest one. So we have just one stickman dancing in the middle. We are breaking the ground around him, which showcases the key, the core mechanic of the game, what you're actually going to do in this game. But you don't have any other objects which are distracting you from this gameplay. And this brings us to the conclusion that actually the creatives which are more, which are cleaner, simpler, more minimalistic, they have a greater potential to decrease your CPI rather than just recreating this game, your gameplay with something trendy or epic or something which just looks cool. So don't hesitate to clear up your screen to make it as understandable as possible, and still keep an eye on the core mechanic. It should be showcased really well. And of course, nowadays, as we mentioned during the panel, the games are becoming as complicated as ever. So we have plenty of games with different level types, gameplays. Some of them are just compilations of mini games. So, but how to prioritize this content? What's the most marketable content for your players? And we had a similar story with our game Samurai Slashed, which was developed together with our external partner Indie Games. So they brought up this game where we need to slash the objects which are upcoming at us. Good in-game KPIs again, but 52 cents CPI. So we wanted to find out what's the most marketable part of the game. And we made a lot of creatives showcasing different moments at the game and different level types. And here's what we got. We discovered that boss level, where the stickman is shooting at us and we are slicing his bullets, is the most marketable one. And we actually immediately made it the first level in the game, which gave us additional 4% day one retention. And this actually showcases how important it is to check the marketability of every type of your gameplay. If you have a complex game which consists of different levels, don't hesitate to make a separate creatives for each of those gameplays and try to test it, analyze the results, and bring them, put the most marketable content in the beginning of a game. This way you serve your player directly as he arrives into your game. And, of course, let's talk a bit about monetization. Rewarded videos are our favorite, They are bringing the most money to us, and of course they don't harm retention. And sometimes when they implement it wisely, they even have a potential to increase your retention. So traditionally we can see in the games that we have rewarded video placements when we have a currency multiplier at the end of a level, which is usually with top timing, or you have a chest room where you unlock the chest and watch a rewarded video to to open additional chests. It's pretty classic. You can see it in almost every game nowadays. But we ran a different experiment with our internal lab on the games called Crowd Defense on the left and Just Survive on the right. We brought those rewarded video opportunities closer to the gameplay. So here on the right part of the screenshots, you can see an opportunity to unleash a rain or a storm on your players. So it actually brings the rewarded videos closer to the gameplay and allows the player to impact the level immediately. It kills almost all the enemies. It looks fantastic. It looks very mesmerizing, makes him feel omnipowerful. So, and also, as you can see on Crowd Defense, you can, for example, watch rewarded videos to get infinite ammo during one level. And also you can shoot a diegetic box, which you can see on the top of a screenshot, to have an additional boost for rewarded video. And actually bringing those rewarded videos closer to the gameplay allowed us to double the amount of rewarded videos per daily active user, which of course significantly increases LTV. So when you're thinking about monetization opportunities in your game, don't hesitate to monetize something which is directly connected to your core gameplay. Add an opportunity to watch a rewarded video during the level. This way you create very desirable advertising for your players. So, and as we talked already during the panel, we have higher CPIs nowadays. Lower CPIs are very rare, and with iOS 14 they're gonna get even rarer. So we are very interested to boost our LTV as maximum, make it as maximum as possible. And we have a nice case on the, our game, which is called Art Blitz, how we achieved a very high LTV. So this game has not only day one or day seven retention, it has day 30 retention and the day 30 LTV, which was over $1 during its peak. So it's actually not so much in the context of this game in particular, because its CPI grew drastically from 30 to 70 cents. And it's most likely due to the fact that it's a bit niche compared to usual hyper-casual games. But still, it was plenty enough to make it profitable. So how we achieved this high LTV? First is, of course, a very sticky core mechanic, which was suggested by our external developer, Artem. So he made this game having at the core this tile connection, tile rearrangement, which forms a painting in the end, which is very juicy and gave us 20 minutes playtime, which is quite a lot. Then we optimized progression. So we increase the amount of tiles as soon as you progress in the game. So in later levels, you have more tiles per painting. And sometimes we suggest a difficult level, which you can see on the right video. So you need to assemble a painting consisting of several segments. And actually, this is not more difficult, as you can see. It just takes more time. However, coupled with a disclaimer that it's difficult, it gives a player higher sense of accomplishment as soon as he finishes the level, and therefore boosts retention. And third element which allowed us to achieve such an LTV was meta, and especially collections. So it played two very important roles. First of all, we were showcasing the content which is upcoming. So the player can see what's gonna be next and he wants to unblock those things. And the visualizing the previous progress allows us to trigger something which is called sunk cost bias in people. So this is some psychological mechanism which allows you to, which prevents you from stopping doing something in which you already invested a lot of time. So player sees all his progress, visualizing this collection, and he is unlikely to churn. He wants to finish that stuff, and which also increased retention, as you can guess. So when you're trying to maximize your LTV, always think about those three factors. Come up with a core mechanic, which is sticky, which gives you good play time, something which player can enjoy for a long time, something mesmerizing. Then think about progression, how to make it smooth and offer sometimes something more demanding to your players. And then, of course, try to leverage psychological mechanisms of the players by your meta. Visualize the previous progress and showcase the upcoming content. It's especially important if your game is based on content. So, and last but not least, we wanted to warn you from blindly copying and transposing some features. We are living in an industry which is based on benchmarking, so you might see some hit game and see a nice feature in it and think like, oh, I should for sure have it in my game, but that would be too easy actually. So here are a couple of examples why it doesn't work. So first, we tried to implement a very trendy thing in two of our internal games. We implemented the world roadmap in Just Survive, and it worked perfectly. It boosted retention by 20%, and we were really happy. So we implemented it in Crowd Defense. And in Crowd Defense, it didn't make any sense. It didn't actually boost KPIs, it didn't even change them. And the reason why is that players are playing those two different games because of they have different motivations. So in Crowd Defense, you need to actually shoot enemies. So you are interested in becoming progressively stronger, into boosting your weapons. And from the other hand, you just enjoy dispersing, shooting enemies. Their crowds, which are coming at you. Meanwhile, Just Survive is heavily based on content. You are escaping from sharks, from lions, from tsunami, and of course you are asking yourselves what's going to be next. So again, this stuff, roadmap, it showcases previous progress and teases the upcoming content. And it makes sense in content-based games, but not in Crowd Defense. And other failed attempts to integrate trendy features to games. So we tried to add an idle village into Just Survive, and it didn't really work. We tried it two times, at the very beginning after adding some storytelling. And also we added some diegetic hub in Parkour Assassin. We first saw it in the game called Titans 3D and Lumbercraft. So we thought that we should for sure have it in our game, but we were wrong. And this actually reminds us of the fact that meta doesn't have a capacity to profoundly change the KPIs of your game. It has only a capacity to leverage something which the player already finds satisfying in your game. And for example, on the contrary to Parkour Assassin, in Titans 3D, the diegetic hub is actually a reference to the anime which inspired the game itself. So it made more sense. It was more coherent with the core gameplay. And the last experiment which we ran on Crowd Defense was about advertising placement. So the classic way to display advertising in hyper-casual games is to show a rewarded video opportunity after the player won a level. And then if he refuses, you show him an interstitial. So this is both very classic and efficient, but some industry professionals were talking about the fact that actually showing interstitial before a win page can boost your LTV. And then afterwards you suggest them a rewarded video. So it's supposed to boost your LTV because some players gonna watch interstitial and rewarded videos at the same time. However, in our game, it had the opposite result. The LTV went down because players which were seeing an interstitial, they were unlikely to watch a rewarded video afterwards. And also, some players who were always watching a rewarded video faced an interstitial for the first time. And they actually got pissed that there is some advertising they can't skip, which they didn't want, and they churned from a game. So that actually reminds us that you should really adjust the monetization strategy to your game. The results are highly depending on your KPIs, on your session length, and on overall appeal of your game. So copy-pasting monetization strategy from one game to another one just doesn't work. It should be really individual. So, and overall, if you find something trendy, if you find that you like something in other games, try to ask yourself why it should be in my game, what it actually leverages, what would be the benefits of it. And of course, don't hesitate to A/B test all those features. So I hope you enjoyed those 10 bite-sized case studies, and I hope it will help you to tackle the same problems in your games, and also inspire you to do experiments on your own. And of course, in hyper-casual, as you know, nothing is set in stone, so there are plenty more lessons to learn out there, and we will continue experimenting, and we'll be eager to share it with you. Thank you.
Thank you so much. It was really awesome to listen to you, and especially compare what was stated during the panel and what you have told during the case study regarding the in-game setting. Panelists told avoid creating an in-game setting and avoid storytelling. And some of your cases were based, actually, on changing setting and changing the storytelling. So, guys, there are no rules. Forget everything the panelists told you. Just do whatever you want to make your game profitable. This is what we can learn from
most of the cases. Actually, confirming what we said during the panel. But yeah, there are some, exceptions.
Who has questions?
In both Russian or English. And any questions?
In one language, yeah, in any.
hello. I would like to ask you one question. What do you think will be the next big thing in hyper-casual? I mean, if you like look both retrospective and all those trends which are happening right now, what do you think? I totally understand it's kind of like a bit speculative, but what do you think?
Well, if I knew what's the next biggest thing in hyper-casual, I would be already a millionaire, I guess. So, but there are some trends I can highlight, actually. So, first one, I would say that the whole industry is moving towards ASMR-ish mechanics, ASMR-ish gameplay. So first, it started from simulation games. 1 year ago, where we were peeling something or making something out of clay or some very visually pleasing stuff. And now we can see it literally everywhere. We have so many runners, puzzle games with very satisfying visuals. And we think it is something which player needs to relax. It's like adding this ASMR aspect to your game. Automatically make it better. So don't hesitate to also watch TikTok, satisfying videos on YouTube, and try to understand those mechanisms, why it's satisfying. For example, a lot of particles are very satisfying. This is why we have a lot of crowd games on the market nowadays, or peeling something, or I don't know, interacting with something very colorful, very beautiful is also mesmerizing. So this is one trend, and another big trend is feminization of gameplays. So 62% of all hyper-casual players are women, and therefore we can see a switch towards more female themes like family, makeup, nails. We have a lot of female characters, most likely because it's easier for the player to associate with those characters. So it's always a good trick to think about female appeal in your games. So yeah, I would say that those two are sub-trends, you know, like huge trends, which englobe actually probably half of mini trends on the market.
Thank you.
Хотел задать этот вопрос на панели, но Не получилось, поэтому вопрос лично тебе. Mm-hmm. Ходят слухи, что следующий большой тренд в гиперкэжуале – это гибрид-казуальные игры. Что это, как ты к этому относишься и, в принципе, насколько это перехайплено?
Ну, такие слухи ходят уже год, но пока успех Archer никто не повторил еще. Вот, отношусь я к этому, конечно, хорошо, как и к любым инновациям, но дело в том, что для того, чтобы сделать хорошую гибрид-казуальную игру, в ее основе должна лежать очень такая мощная механика, которая будет удерживать игрока в течение долгого времени внутри этой игры. То есть, соответственно, и эту механику нужно как-то масштабировать и окружить сочной, классной метой. Это очень сложно на самом деле, то есть это задача для больших студий. Я бы не советовала, например, начинать с этого, потому что, не освоив гиперкэжуал, невозможно освоить гибрид-кэжуал. То есть это вообще, как бы, я бы сказала, что я бы не советовала начинающим это делать. Вот. То есть, скорее всего, конечно, будут игры гибрид-казуальные, да, но это будет всегда как бы достаточно нишевая история, потому что, чтобы эта игра была успешной, нужно попасть именно в точку. Нужно найти такую механику, которая действительно будет как бы достаточно глубокой, как бы, как мы говорили про глубину геймплея, да, которая будет достаточно понятной в то же время, да, чтобы она была понятна из видео, и чтобы мета, которая прикреплена к этой механике, она прям попадала в точку и именно использовала самые сочные, как бы самые классные моменты этой механики и продавала нам рекламу более успешно. То есть это много факторов, которые должны сойтись для того, чтобы гибрид-казуальная игра стала успешной. И пока, на самом деле, ну, никому это не удалось сделать. Это не значит, что не стоит пытаться. Это значит, что просто нужно как-то, ну, более аналитически подойти к этому и, возможно, скажем так, не делать это своим приоритетом. А, например, если у вас появится такая идея интересная, то, конечно, попробуйте сделать. Но не надо делать это, как бы, не надо рассматривать гибрид-кэжуал как абсолютную цель, как будто маркет движется только туда. Нет, мы заметили, что рынок движется во множество разных направлений одновременно, на самом деле, и это прекрасно.
Спасибо. Так, у кого еще есть вопросы? О, класс. Я уже привык, что эта часть зала не очень активна.
Спасибо за доклад, очень интересно было. Подскажите, вот эти вот эксперименты с тем, как смена сеттинга меняет, уменьшает CPI, насколько это актуальная информация, то есть как давно это происходили, эти эксперименты, собственно?
Вот, собственно говоря, эксперимент с Master Thief, нашей хитовой игрой, да, он проходил давно, то есть это около полтора года назад. А вот с Гарденом, с садоводством, эксперимент очень свежий. То есть, и в принципе, на самом деле, мне кажется, у каждого разработчика наберется полно таких экспериментов, когда он поменял сеттинг, и все стало прекрасней. То есть, как бы, это не панацея, но так может случиться, особенно, как бы, если изначально был выбран более нишевый сеттинг.
Спасибо. Так, есть ли еще вопросы? Ага.
Тут возвращаюсь, спасибо за доклад, возвращаясь к фразе, сказанной на панели, скорее, не к теме доклада, вы сказали, что смотрите на идеи, которые протестированы за 5 лет, но маркет очень быстро меняется, и то, что тестировали 5 лет назад, может быть не очень актуально, а точнее, скорее всего, не актуально сейчас. Как конкретно вы процессите эти идеи, которые, там, не знаю, вы тестировали 4 года назад, 5 лет назад?
То есть, например, это происходит так, спасибо за вопрос. К нам приходит разработчик с идеей. Мы смотрим, так, сначала мы смотрим на глазок, напоминает ли нам вообще это что-нибудь. Может быть, мы это уже где-то видели. Вот, если мы сомневаемся, мы показываем всем остальным. Может, кто-то другой видел. Вот. Если мы находим похожий геймплей в нашей библиотеке, соответственно, мы смотрим, в чем отличие идеи. Может ли разработчик, например, сделать это красивее? Да? Может ли он сделать это в AAA качестве? Если да, то можно сделать то же самое вообще, просто, ну, как бы напихать тут других механик и все. В принципе, графика, она становится наиболее, ну, как бы очень важной в гиперкэжуале, и это может помочь, да. Потом мы смотрим, как бы если прям точно такое же было сделано в таком же качестве, то, ну, наверное, в этом нет смысла в том, чтобы делать это еще раз, в одну реку как бы дважды не вступишь, вот обычно.
А вы тестируете, например, старые креативы, чтобы посмотреть, насколько они перформят, например, трехлетней давности вот сейчас, как они перформят? Потому что, я так понимаю, в индустрии есть достаточно кейсов, когда креатив в определенное время не зашел, его перетестировали, и потом он показал достаточно хорошие метрики.
Ну, если это имеет смысл, то, конечно, мы можем перетестировать. Например, хорошим поводом протестировать еще раз старый креатив является разработка игры на похожую тему или использование похожей механики. То есть, если мы видим в нашей библиотеке такое видео, мы тестируем еще раз либо на CTR, либо возвращаемся к результатам того теста. Они, конечно, мало нам скажут о том, какие метрики будут в этот раз, но все-таки мы анализируем наш предыдущий опыт. Потом... Очень часто бывает, что разработчик приходит с какой-то идеей, она была уже сделана, но сейчас, пересмотрев эти креативы, например, нам приходит в голову, например, добавить туда какой-то трендовый элемент, какие-то, например, мультипликаторы, которые сейчас популярны, да, и иногда возникает как бы такая лампочка над головой, и мы думаем, что «О, вот этого-то как раз не хватало». И можно, конечно, воскресить вот эти старые игры добавлением в них новых механик, более современных, или добавлением туда какой-то истории интересной, вот.
Спасибо. Есть ли еще вопросы, ребят? Спасибо огромное за доклад и за ответ на вопросы.